This episode is brought to you through a collaboration with the Smithsonian's National Museum of Natural History in Washington, D.C., and the Field Museum in Chicago, Illinois.
We're here at the Smithsonian's Whale Warehouse. It's the largest collection of whale material found anywhere in the world. And when I say the largest, I mean the largest.
The whale warehouses are located at the Museum Support Center in Maryland, about 45 minutes away from the Smithsonian's location on the Mall. It's actually two giant warehouses that house both extant and extinct specimens. With over 500,000 square feet of storage space, the Museum Support Center is home to some of the largest specimens ever collected, like the 23-foot-long right and left jawbones of the largest blue whale specimen in any museum in the world. Today, we're going to talk with Curator of Marine Mammals, Dr. Michael McGowen, about cetaceans, marine mammals like whales, dolphins, and porpoises, and see how the Smithsonian's Natural History Museum is using their collections in unexpected ways to better understand this diverse group of animals.
First, I just wanted to show this sort of generic bottlenose dolphin that's in all of the aquaria that people are really familiar with, and compare that to all these bizarre forms over here. So these two guys right here, these are different river dolphins. So this is an Amazon river dolphin, as well as a Indian River dolphin. And they're actually not that closely related to one another, but they seem to have invaded river systems separately.
So this is a case of convergent evolution.
Yes, it is. So the invasion of rivers is an incidence of convergent evolution. And the really bizarre thing with the Indian River dolphin is that it has these growths on the skull, which some people have interpreted it as an adaptation for navigating in riverine environments where they can't really sense where they're going with vision. So they use their echolocation and it reverberates off the bone.
What?
And focuses it so that they can see through the water, through their through sounds. Bottlenose dolphins have echolocation as well, but they don't have these strange bony protuberances. So they can still use echolocation, but they focus it out broadly into their environment.
Gotcha.
So this is in the category of bizarre things in the collection, and this is a skin of an Indian river dolphin. What we can do today is sample DNA from things like specimens like this and get an idea of genetics in the past. I mean, this was collected in 1910, and we can compare it to this species today and, for instance, see if there's a reduction in diversity, or in the case of rare specimens, this might be one of the few specimens left of this particular species outside of India, for instance, or Pakistan.
So that's a great example of how when this thing was collected and prepared for a museum, it wasn't clear how it could be used in the future, but
now,
thanks to technology and advancements in DNA, you can make use of it in a way that was not predicted before.
Exactly, and we can do that with bone as well. We can get DNA out of bone. So all of these specimens right here now become genetic repositories of specific points and specific places all over the globe into the past.
That's pretty mind-blowing.
It is pretty mind-blowing.
That's pretty amazing. Can I smell it?
Is sure.
This weird? I'm sorry.
It's not weird at all. I mean, the smell of marine mammals is lovely.
It smells just like leather. This smells just like shoes.
Well, it's made out of a lot of the same material that our skin
is. This smells pretty good.
So this is a pygmy sperm whale.
What?
And they probably have some of the most asymmetric skulls within cetaceans. So this is their nasal passage right here. So it goes up to the blowhole. And you can see this side is much larger than this side. And that's, again, because of echolocation. When they emit these sounds through their nasal passages, they're able to tell the direction of sound.
What?
So they can tell if a fish is coming towards them by this asymmetry.
That blew my mind.
And these animals are really bizarre. They also have a anal sac that they can squirt ink out of. Yes, it's really, really bizarre.
Hold up. Like a squid.
Like a squid.
But
they feed on squid, and people think that they actually save some of the ink and use it to squirt out at predators.
Wow, I had no idea. So these guys are just weirdos.
They're weirdos, yes. So cetaceans have evolved a lot of bizarre tooth morphologies. And
like this guy.
One example is a narwhal's tusk that I'm sure everyone is familiar with because everyone's obsessed with narwhals these days.
Yeah.
So the tusk is for the most part found in males, although 10% of females have a tusk. One of the interesting things is that they use this potentially for male-male competition, although it's not really known what they use this for, although there's some other theories like detecting salinity or using it as a sensory organ.
But nobody really knows for sure.
No one really knows for sure. I mean, we can observe how it's used, but testing why it evolved is sort of a difficult question to get at.
Mystery of the universe. Yeah. What is this thing?
So this is a model of a different species called the strap-toothed whale, and their tusks actually grow together and completely enclose the mouth. It can only open its jaw just a little bit.
How does it eat anything?
Well, it feeds on squid, so it just sucks the squid in, and so it doesn't really necessarily need a huge gape. Yeah, this is just one of the more bizarre cetacean morphologies. I mean, there's a lot of them.
That's very weird.
They're a very weird group of animals as far as teeth goes.
So we were just talking about sort of the diversity of cetaceans themselves, and we're obviously here in a museum collection, but we don't just look at the skeletal material when you have questions that you need to answer.
Yeah, so I just brought out a bunch of different other things that we might collect. One of the things that people might be aware of is baleen. So a lot of the really large whales don't have any teeth, and they feed by filtering through baleen.
That's what this is.
So that's what this is. And as you can see on the side here, there's lots of different plates. The water comes through here, and then it gets caught in this fringe-like...
Hair-like
stuff right there. Baleen is one of the different substances that we can use to tell about the life history of a particular whale. What we know is that the baleen grows incrementally throughout the lifetime of the whale. So by drilling at different time points, we can get a picture of what the whale was doing at that point during its lifestyle.
Wow.
So you can look at hormones, you can look at cortisol levels, so levels of stress, isotopes to tell what it was feeding on or where it may have been feeding. And we can actually go back in time to baleen specimens that we have from the 1800s.
Wow.
And even look at, you know, what whale life was like back then.
That's amazing. So it's like a time machine.
It is, exactly.
Through the
like
mouth
a time
of a
machine.
Whale.
Yes, yes. One of the other pieces of a whale that we can use to study about their life is the earwax.
Their earwax?
Their earwax. So it's not the same as our earwax, but it is a lipid-like structure that exists in the ear canal of a whale. Incrementally through the life of a whale, different layers are put down, so we can actually use this to age really large whales.
So it puts down layers like a tree, like the trunk
of a tree. So this is a tree, whale's tree ring, basically. From its ear canal,
That's
yes.
That's a little gross, but I'm okay with it. So in this sort of smorgasbord of interesting whale artifacts, we also have this rather fragrant piece of what looks like resin. What is this?
So this is ambergris, and this is from the intestinal tract of a sperm whale. And even today, this is used in perfumes because it actually smells wonderful. It smells very musky.
Admittedly, it does smell really good.
Yeah.
It kind of smells like sandalwood or an earthy sort of tree-like smell. But I couldn't picture it. Well, I would say I can actually picture myself going on a beach and picking up something and being like, yes,
and
I enjoy that smell.
Yeah, it's basically condensed waxy whale poo.
Oh, cool. Well, that's a way to describe it. Neat. So we've talked a lot today about the diversity of whales and the availability of their specimens in collections, like the one here at Smithsonian. And we sort of have this last little specimen to talk about, which I think hits it home why it's so important that these collections exist and why they're available for research.
This is a species called the vaquita porpoise. It lives in the Gulf of California in Mexico. And at the moment, there are only 17 of these guys left. And, this is sort of a cautionary tale. But at least we have this at the museum. So, you know, 100 years from now, I mean, hopefully they won't go extinct. But if they do, we have representations of them in the museum.
And this little skull can help answer questions about an organism that might not be available to study in the wild.
Exactly. And we don't know what, you know, interesting new scientific advances are going to happen and what information we could actually get out of the skull. When some of these things were collected in the 1880s, they had no clue that we could get DNA out of them or what DNA was, or things like, you know, isotopes or getting hormones out of baleen. But it's nice that all of this stuff is here, and, you know, every single one of these specimens, no matter how old, are valuable.
Thanks, museums. It still has brains on it.